Good morning. I would like to welcome all of our guests today. One of my special friends has put a note right here on the pulpit. Welcome guests. Thank you. If you are visiting with us today, we want to say a special welcome to you. There are cards in the little rack in front of you. If you get kind of bored with the service, you can fill it out. Even if you don't get bored with the service, put your name and information. We'd like to know about your visit. We have some special guests with us today. Scott Franklin. You know Scott? Scott's been around a while, and he's been part of us here at this church, and he's gone off out in the other world, but he came back today to sing for us. He might give us a devotional, and then all I'll have to do is say amen. Fat chance that's going to happen, huh? Well, I'm sort of in slow motion today. My wife insisted that I go with our daughter, granddaughter, and my wife to see The Sound of Music last night at a dinner theater, and I went, and I had to sleep real fast. And if I go to sleep in the middle of the service, Ward, would you wake me up? You heard about the preacher who was preaching and noticed this man was asleep, and he said, "Ma'am, would you wake your husband up?" She said, "You put him to sleep, you wake him up." So I'll try not to go to sleep. And if you try not to go to sleep, then we'll have a good service. It's going to be a good day in the house of the Lord. Amen. And so thanks. Welcome. Did I say that? Welcome. So we've been looking at the Psalms. And today we're looking at the 27th Psalm. The first verse says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?" So I say to all of us today, come, let us lift our voices in praise and worship. For the Lord is our light and our salvation, dispelling all fear and leading in good times and in difficult times. May we pray. Oh God, you are our light and salvation. We come to this place of worship today to find your strength and guidance in times of uncertainty. It is with unwavering trust that we place our fears before you, trusting in your love and protection. Open our hearts and minds and allow us to worship you in spirit and in truth. I pray in your name. Amen.
Thank you. church.
Good morning.
Pinch hitting for Clark this morning, who is on vacation. And we are so pleased to have Scott Franklin with us, not only to bring our special music, but to honor us with singing in the choir this morning. We're happy to have his daughter Annie and her husband with us this morning as well. So as we proceed in our service, if you would, grab either your bulletin or a hymnal, or both, because we're going to sing two songs right in a row. And we'll begin with hymn number 424, Heavenly Sunlight. We're going to sing all three verses, and then we're going to transition right into the Family of God, which is number 386. So if you're willing and able, please stand as we sing.
Isn't it wonderful that we can have worship and have people to lead us in worship, like Cynthia and John. And we're getting ready to have Susan Nally lead the children's sermon, or whatever it's called, moment, just a moment. And it's just good that we have talented people that are willing to step up and to do their part in leading in worship. And they're not here, we're not here on the platform to be seen, but we're here to point. And to point to God. It's not about us. It's about God. Our scripture today is the 27th Psalm. It is printed in your bulletin. This is the NIV, New International Version. This is a Psalm of David. It depends on the translation you use, what the editors might put. Mine has this superscription, Triumphant Song of Confidence. This is a hymn of confidence. The Lord is my light and my salvation, whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life, of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked advance against me and devour me, it is my enemies and my foes who will stumble and fall. Though an army besiege me, my heart will not fear. Though war break out against me, even then I will be confident. One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek Him in His temple. For in the day of trouble He will keep me safe in His dwelling. He will hide me in the shelter of His sacred tent and set me high upon a rock. Then my head will be exalted above the enemies who surround me. At His sacred tent I will sacrifice with shouts of joy. I will sing and make music to the Lord. Hear my voice when I call, Lord. Be merciful to me and answer me. My heart says of You, seek His face, Your face, Lord. I will seek. Do not hide Your face from me. Do not turn Your servant away in anger. You have been my helper. Do not reject me or forsake me, God my Savior. Though my father and mother forsake me, the Lord will receive me. Teach me Your way, Lord. Lead me in a straight path because of my oppressors. Do not turn me over to the desire of my foes. For false witnesses rise up against me, spouting malicious accusations. I remain confident of this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart and wait for the Lord. May we pray. God, we have staked our living and our dying on You. We seek Your presence here today. Teach us Your way, Lord Jesus. Lead us on a well-lighted path. In times when You seem silent, grant us the courage to wait, trusting Your grace that brings Your resurrection power to our dead ends. You're doing a new thing among us. We confess sometimes it's hard to see that. We bring to You our fears about what the future might hold. May we always follow You, Lord. Grant us mercy and grace to trust You more deeply, knowing that the only secure place is with You, our light and salvation, the stronghold of our life. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
All right. Loud. Boys and girls, if you all come on down for a moment, come on up here with me. Good morning. How are you all? Are you ready? Will you turn so you can see me? Will you turn this way? I want to be able to see your pretty face. Thank you. Good morning, everybody. Hello. This morning, I wanted to start off by showing you some pictures of my most favorite things. Are you ready?
Yes.
Okay, here we go.
Snakes.
Snakes? Let's see what else I've got. I like, do you like snakes?
No.
Uh-oh. Oh, what's this? Nobody likes snakes. What's this?
Thunder.
A big old storm. Some of you are giving me weird looks. What about this? Can you tell what this is?
It's too dark.
It is. It's a very dark room, a dark bedroom. Yep. All right, a couple more of my favorite things. What did you say?
Spider.
Oh my goodness. Well, listen. The best I have saved for last. Are you ready for my last favorite thing?
Shot!
Oh, getting a shot. Boys and girls, do you all think that these really are Miss Susan's favorite things?
I got a shot.
No, you got a shot before? You do like snakes. Good. I'm glad somebody does. Boys and girls, these are really things that came from Google's list of things that people are afraid of. Are any of you afraid of some of these things that I showed you?
Shots,
for sure. And Miss Nally's going to tell you, Miss Susan's going to tell you, she does not like spiders.
I'm not snakes.
That's right. And I'm going to... You love them? Okay. Well, I'm glad somebody does. But boys and girls, let me look at me for just a second, because this is so important. All of us have things that we're afraid of. The adults out there, the kids here, and even in the Bible, we can read about powerful King David, who had a whole army that he could send to protect him, and yet he found out that he was afraid. But King David was so smart that when he was afraid, he did something that was very important. What do you think he did? He did. I heard somebody whisper. He said a prayer to God, and he wrote those prayers in Psalms. God wants us to know that he loves us, and that when we're afraid, we should be just like King David, and we should take a moment to pray to God, because he loves us and he cares about us, and he will always listen to us when we're afraid. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? God tells us we don't have to fear anything, even spiders and snakes, or starting to school after summer break. He will be with us. Think you can remember to pray to God when you're afraid? We're all going to try to remember to do that. Okay, bow your heads with me, boys and girls. Here we go. Dear God, thank you so much for these boys and girls and the adults that bring them here each Sunday to learn more about your word and your love for them. We are so thankful, God, for the peace and comfort that you bring to us when we are afraid. In your name I pray. Amen. Okay, you can either go with your adults or you can go with Miss Karis to Children's Church.
Missed. You know, it's interesting. So the song I'm going to sing this morning, I sang for the first time 30 years ago, 93. I was 24 years old. And because of my children celebrating a day last week and the 30 years, you can kind of guess my age from that point. But, you know, I think in that point, John, you were still in high school. You're still in high school. And we had been here for about a year and a half. So there's a lot of special memories I have in this church. My children grew up in this church. My children accepted Jesus in this church. What a wonderful testimony I've just given about the positive impact it's had on my life and my family's life. So, interesting enough, this song that I'm singing, it's Larry Curtis's favorite. And so, it was the reason I sang it the first time. Now, I've sang it several times since, but it's the reason I sang it the first time. But a couple things I want everybody to get out of it. First of all, the smallest things you do for Jesus are noticed. The smallest, most insignificant things that you do for Jesus are noticed. Secondly, all the people that have come into your life and have brought love, peace, joy, and the goodness of our Savior, thank them. Because as I've been through here, the 30 years since I've been here, we've had a lot of people either leave this church or go on to heaven. Sometimes you get to thank them, sometimes you don't. So if you get a chance, thank them. But when we get to heaven, we'll be able to thank them as well. So this song is called Thank You, and I hope you enjoy it. And I hope it plays.
Jesus took your hand and
you stood before the Lord, He said, my child, look around you, for great is your reward. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed. So glad you gave. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you gave. I am so glad you
What a wonderful testimony. Thank you, Scott. It is a reminder, you just never know. You just never know. The good you do in the name of Jesus will make a difference. We're looking at the Psalms. And various people have talked about the various kinds of psalms, the categories of psalms. Some of them are laments, some of them are psalms of praise, some of them are kingly psalms. Walter Brueggemann categorizes them as psalms of orientation, psalms of disorientation, psalms of reorientation. And so some psalms defy putting in a category. Last Sunday we had a psalm of lament, a psalm that the psalmist was crying for help. Today we have a psalm of trust. Verses 1 through 6 is a vibrant hymn of unshakable trust in God. We get the picture of a worshiper who shows full confidence in the knowledge of God. The last half is kind of an anxious lament from a time of great need. The main points of Psalm 27 is a straightforward look at the fears King David had and the trust he had in God. Like King David, we too have fears. David was fearful of his circumstances, and his fear of circumstances was a real thing, and sometimes our fear of our circumstances are a real thing. David did not know if his enemies would make a surprise attack or not. David did not know what would happen, and nor do we. David was in a fix, and we cannot tell exactly where he was, but we think this was really when he was in exile, before he was really the King David. Sometimes we ask ourselves, how did we get ourselves in the fix we're in? Consider the circumstances that the United States was in 90 years ago. We were in the midst of a Great Depression, one of the most severe economic crises in the history. The stock market had crashed in 1929, leading to widespread unemployment and poverty. Franklin Roosevelt was elected president, and at his inaugural address in 1933, he said that iconic phrase, "We have nothing to fear but fear itself." Fear itself were those nameless, unreasoning, unjustified terrors that paralyzed the country. And with this statement, Roosevelt encouraged the American people not to succumb to fear, but to face the circumstances, the challenges, with courage and determination. Consider our circumstances in America right now and in the past few years. We have undergone a pandemic. We are in the midst of political turmoil and crisis. Our world is more polarized now, maybe than ever before. Wars exist in various parts of the world, and the United States are part of those. But today I point you to King David the poet, and not to President Roosevelt. Our superpower today is the same as David's was a century ago. The secret of David's public confidence was his private obedience. He took time to fellowship with the Lord. Fear of circumstances. He had it, we have it. Fear of failure was a real thing for David and for us. David's confidence in God did not prevent him from being concerned about himself. I like what someone has said. It's one thing to behold the Lord in the sanctuary and quite something else to see the enemy approaching in the battlefield. It's quite one thing for us to come and worship God here on Sunday, but quite another thing to face the challenges of our day-to-day lives. Years ago, I wrote a book titled When Crisis Comes Home. It's way out of date. But some of the truth I think I said in that book is true for today. I reminded the readers that the word crisis in the Chinese language is made up of two symbols, two words, danger and opportunity. A crisis provides us with the potential to make things better. A crisis provides us with challenges, but it can go either way. Catastrophe can happen. But we can be transformed by the crisis. How many times have I seen, how many times have you seen a person, a family, experience some external crisis, a crisis that happens to them? Even before the crisis, life may seem like it's headed toward collapse, but the crisis can be a wake-up call, and in a strange and mysterious way can get people motivated, and God is brought into the mix, and it's as if a miracle happened. The person, the family, is transformed in a positive way. But just the opposite can happen. A crisis can further divide and isolate. Failure in life, failure on the battlefield, failure in families is a real thing. But God was with King David. He feared failure, but he trusted in God. As with David, so with us. It's one thing to behold the Lord in the sanctuary, and quite something else to face the enemy in battlefield. Fear of circumstances was real for David, and it's real for us. Fear of failure was real for David, and it's real for us. Fear of the future was a real thing for David and for us. David wrote these words before the battle was over. As a wise leader, he realized one victory did not guarantee the enemy would stop attacking. David faced his fear with trust. Trust in God. In the first section, it talks about David's confidence brought about because of victory of faith. The victory was not just on the battlefield. The victory was the victory of faith. Before the battle is won on the battlefield, it is won in the mind and in the soul of the soldier, the marine, the sailor. Before the victory is won in life, it is won in faith in God. Before an athlete ever wins the game, he or she must deal with self and win the internal battle. A sportsman knows that much of the game includes athleticism. Yes, of course. But it includes mindset. The competitive mindset is the attitude you want during competition, such as performing athletically, competing aggressively, having a laser focus, and being resilient. David makes triumphant assertions in these verses because of his experience. This second section talks about his confidence brought about because of his hope and faith in God, his trust in God. His trust was built on his experience and on the presence of God. He says these words, "I want to dwell in your temple all the time. I want to see your face all the time." Now imagine that. Here is King David, a leader of battle. And if we take it literally, it sounds like he just wants to sit in church all the time. Well, I really don't think that's what he meant. I think he meant he wanted to have God's presence with him at all the time. And the result was he could lift his head high and he could walk in battle. Trust in God, trust built in the presence of God. David needed that. We need that. David had the confidence in the benefits of God's presence in the face of all his anxieties. Now, as you may know, I don't just stand up here and make up this stuff. Well, sometimes I read. And one of the sources that I have used repeatedly in recent weeks is a man by the name of Rolf Jacobson. Now, I didn't know much about him. I like what he said. He's a professor at Luther Seminary. He's got all the credentials. He has a PhD from Princeton. He reads Hebrew, something I can't do. And I read what he put on either LinkedIn or Facebook. I can't remember. "I am a Lutheran pastor and seminary professor. My spiritual gifts include snarkiness, teaching, cooking steak and scrambled eggs, and reading Hebrew poetry. My favorite books are Psalms, the Gospel of Mark, Isaiah, Galatians, and Amos. Three keys to my life are faith in Jesus, family, and friends." And this is what got me. "I am a cancer survivor and a double amputee." What? I listened to him on podcasts. I didn't know that. And then he offered a personal story about this psalm that touched me. He says, as a personal note, Psalm 27 is a favorite psalm of my own. The first verse alone, "The Lord is my light and my salvation, whom shall I fear?" has helped me get through many a long night of the soul. When I was a teenager, I developed bone cancer, which took both of my legs. Wow. As I came through the dark days of cancer, I grew in my trust of God. I never got my legs back, of course, but I learned that God, my light and salvation, is with me always. Powerful. And then he has a note to us preachers. When preaching the Psalms of trust, be sure to emphasize that these Psalms are perfectly clear on how dangerous and deadly life can be, but also that they are words of trust from those who have been there before, who've had the bottom drop out, but who cried to the Lord and were saved. David did that. Many of you have done that. This psalm expresses the very real danger which the psalmist is facing. It's not a spiritual danger, but a physical one. The threats of illness, death, unemployment, poverty, climate change, physical violence are real for people in our world and for each of us. Challenging circumstances are very real. God does not always change our circumstances for us, but He changes us for our circumstances. The Lord is my light. We live in a world, excuse my grammar, that is lit up. Street lights. There are lights everywhere. Have you ever flown at night? Unless you're out over the ocean, just about anywhere you fly, there are lights, lights, lights. The 21st century is a light. In America is a time of lights everywhere. Most of us have little concept of true darkness and how disorienting darkness can be. The truth of this psalm is a God who is light and a God who shines in utter darkness. Jesus said, "I am the light of the world." Jesus, who is the light, is also our refuge in times of trouble. This is the God in whom we can pour out our trust. Have faith. Do not despair. The days of disorientation are over. May we pray. God of goodness and mercy, we pray that you would be the light of our salvation and sustain our souls. We offer our daily lives to you. We submit to your will. We love you. Renew us and transform us by your steadfast love into your people, is my prayer today. Amen. Amen. Thank you for coming. In a moment, we're going to sing a hymn of invitation. John Pumphrey's going to come and lead that. It's a time of commitment. This church has a tradition. If it's been your birthday in the past week or next week, you come down and you rededicate your life to living for Christ one more year. And so I know there's some of you have had birthdays and you're going to be walking down the aisle. And this is the time, if you want to give your life to Jesus and come for baptism, walk down here. Tell me about it. Perhaps you're a member of another church and you want to join this church. As the old saying goes, the doors of the church are open. We welcome you to come. Would you come as we stand and as we sing?
Thank you.
Wow.
Anybody else?
Okay, let's see if I can get this right. Scott Franklin's had a birthday.
I have 17. Yep. Not my 17th birthday.
Your 17th birthday? Wow. You've had a hard life if you're 17. Jackie Hodgkins has had a birthday, and he's going to have surgery next week on his hip. Let's remember him.
July the 14th is my birthday. I was 87.
You don't look a day over. Okay. Clay Wills, we ain't going to tell you how old he is. Carlene Burkhead, I'll be careful. Happy birthday. I'm coming back to you. Braden Hall, Colton Baldwin, Michelle Turner. I'm John Lepper. Hollins Pumphrey, who is as tall as me, comes to receive Christ and for baptism. She's been thinking about this, as have some other young people. We've talked to them. They're thinking about it. And you're praying with them and for them. Now, just stay right where you are, because I have several announcements I want to make. And then we're going to have a closing prayer, and you're going to stand right here, and everybody's going to come hug your neck. I don't know if they'll hug yours, Jackie, but anyway. Whatever. Don Burgess is in the Willows. He was 90 years old as of the 22nd. Was that yesterday?
Yeah,
90. And then let me see. We will. Tell me. Is it? She's almost as old as you? Joanne Dove. We will have no children's church next Sunday. It is the fifth Sunday. Normally the children would be singing, but they're not quite ready. But still, we're not having children's church. So we'll be with your parents this coming Sunday. This coming Thursday evening at 6 p.m., we're having Come to the Table. That continues to expand as we help some people in our community and as we have a good time doing it. Okay? Thank you for coming. It's been a good day. May we pray. Lord, we thank you for your presence here. We thank you for these who have come on their birthday to recommit their lives to you. We thank you for Hollins for coming and for baptism, for this decision. We pray that you would bless her, that she might follow you all the days of her life. Thank you for your presence with us. Thank you that you are our light and our salvation. Help us to stay on the lighted path that you provide. I pray in Christ's name.